Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the town and country planning general permitted development and use classes, Scotland Miscellaneous Amendment Order 2023 from Tom Arthur, who's the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. And Mr. Arthur is joined for this item by Tom Winter, who's the Head of Development Delivery at the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here to provide some clarification around what we're doing around PDR and UCO. As you will be aware, the government is carrying out a substantial review of permitted development rights as part of its wider planning reform programme. The review has been taken forward on a phased basis, with each phase focusing on new and extended permitted development rights for specific types of development. The Town and Country Planning and General Permitted Development Scotland Order 1992 grants planning permission for certain types of development. These are known as permitted development rights. Permitted development rights, or PDR, help provide certainty and save the time and expense associated with applying for planning permission. Phase 2 of the review has focused on new permitted development rights and changes to the use class order related to electric vehicle charging infrastructure, town centre changes of use and ports. A 12-week public consultation on proposed changes was carried out between May and August of last year. The statutory instrument would bring into force a package of measures stemming from that consultation. The measures it contains will help to support the rollout of EV charging infrastructure across Scotland, including modern high-powered chargers, promote the resilience and recovery of Scotland's tenters and provide greater flexibility to Scotland's port operators. I understand that the committee is seeking some clarification in relation to the provisions that are intended to support our city, town and local centres. In summary, these provide greater flexibility to change the use of certain buildings and place furniture outside specified hospitality premises. Taken together, these changes are intended to meet a number of aims: to make places more vibrant and welcoming by encouraging the use of outdoor spaces and the reuse of vacant shops and other premises, to promote diverse and mixed uses in our centres, helping them to become more responsive to changing circumstances, and to encourage local enterprise, entrepreneurship and innovation, as well as the establishment of 20-minute neighbourhoods. The PDR allowing hospitality businesses to place furniture on the pavement adjacent to their premises without a planning application will simplify the process by reducing the number of separate consents that need to be sought. At present, placing furniture on the road, on a public road, would require the consent of the Roads Authority under the Roads Scotland Act 1984 if it would cause an obstruction. Planning permission might be required if the works are taken to involve development. Local authority licensing may also apply. Although the new regulations grant planning permission for furniture on pavements, they do not withdraw other controls addressing safety or access issues using roads legislation and local licensing requirements. The new PDR makes clear that consent from the local council in its capacity as roads authority continues to be required if placing furniture on the road under the PDR would cause an obstruction. Section 59 of the Roads Scotland Act 1984 states that the consent of the roads authority is required before anything such as furniture is placed on the road if it would cause an obstruction, and this definition of roads includes the pavement. A roads authority can refuse consent or impose conditions if it thinks an obstruction has an unacceptable impact on access or safety. Placing something in a road which causes an obstruction without the relevant consent is an offence, and roads authorities have powers to remove obstructions and recover the cost of doing so. The potential for furniture located in the public realm to cause obstruction and for this to adversely impact on accessibility is something we have been keenly aware of throughout this phase of the programme. Public spaces should be as accessible as possible, and we recognise that street furniture, if located insensitively, can create difficulties for disabled people. That is why accessibility considerations were explicitly highlighted through the public consultation process, and we specifically sought views on these points. It is important to reiterate that other existing controls will continue to apply. These ensure authorities can continue to restrict and remove furniture which has an unacceptable impact on safety or access. The measures strike a sensible balance between supporting hospitality by removing overlapping consenting processes while retaining proportionate controls over obstructions which block pavements and the public realm. And on that, I'll conclude and would be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much for that opening statement, and I'm sure we've got a number of questions to go a little bit deeper in there. I mean, clearly, specifically in 1B on centres, we had during the pandemic, we saw when we were coming back from that, the great work around the spaces for people and this idea of moving towards a more European approach with outdoor spaces and creating that interaction between people and outdoor activity. So I think it's commendable in that way, but I think we do have a number of concerns, and as you'll be aware of the concerns that have been raised by RNIB and Living Streets around how do those communities, if there is a problem, how do they actually find the way to have the changes made? And I know you kind of laid it out there, but just how would that work in effect if there was a problem, if somebody who was blind that found it difficult to move around the street furniture needed something changed, how would they go about that?
Well, as I say, under the provisions of the Roads Scotland Act 1984, there is a means for local authorities as the Roads Authority to ensure that the public realm is not being blocked or made less accessible, and they have enforcement powers to ensure that they can take action where appropriate. So for anyone experiencing a set of circumstances where furniture was placed in an insensitive way that impacted upon accessibility, they would be able to raise that directly with their local authority, who through the existing statutory provisions would be able to take action to ensure that any obstruction is removed.
Thanks for that. Do anyone else have any questions? Mark, Willie, Mark first.
Thanks, Camina. I'm just wondering about how the public get the opportunity to object or not to the appropriateness of an outdoor hospitality area. I think, you know, if you move into a town or a village centre where you're near a pub or a restaurant, you know what you're going to, and you know if that the scope of that community is going to change, that generally you'll get the opportunity to object or not to a planning application. There will be many families who live round, especially in small towns and villages that I represent, who live round a local pub and who wouldn't necessarily want to see outdoor seated areas just because of the general noise associated with that and living with young families. How would those people get the opportunity to have a say in how their immediate vicinity of their house was going to change?
Well, I touched on the points previously with regards to concerns around obstructions, but more, it's also important to bear in mind that many hospitality establishments, of course, will be subject to local licensing requirements as well, which I appreciate the former councillor, you're familiar with the established processes for achieving that. So there's an opportunity through direct engagement with a local authority to engage in issues, and clearly there are other provisions which any hospitality establishment would be subject to in and of itself, around levels of noise, impact upon amenity, environmental health, etc. So there's a range of existing mechanisms in place. What we have at the moment is overlapping consenting mechanisms, and it's also important to recognise that it's not always necessarily the case that outdoor furniture would constitute development for planning purposes. So there can be instances where there could be outdoor furniture which would not be captured by the planning system as it exists at the moment. So there are other means of addressing any particular concerns that a local community should have, whether that be around obstruction or indeed whether it should be things that perhaps impinge upon existing licensing arrangements. Tom, I don't know if you want to add anything.
No, I think that covers it well. I think the other thing to note is that it is open to local authorities through the roads consenting process to kind of seek the views of stakeholders or the public if they saw fit to do so, even though it's not necessarily a statutory consultation process in the way that it is under planning.
Yeah, I appreciate the roads authority would look at it, but they would look at it on a very technical basis in terms of access and safety, and I'm more concerned about the noise and nuisance impact of families who live in the vicinity. So could I just clarify that any outdoor seated area would require an amended licensing application, and that would give local families, local residents the opportunity to feed in their views to the licensing authority?
Well, these matters obviously are decisions for the local authority to take as a licensing authority and will be based upon the specific circumstances there. But I have confidence and trust local authorities to apply the existing legislative provisions and to do so in a way that is proportionate and takes account of concerns raised by local people. But the important point to remember here is what we are seeking to do is removing overlapping consenting regimes that exist. So this does not impact, as we've touched on, roads. It does not impact upon any existing licensing requirements. So any development at the moment that would be that would come into the scope of licensing issues, that is not impacted by the change around planning. So these existing provisions would continue as they are.
And I think on the specific issue of noise, that's, as the Minister has said, kind of the subject of environmental health and nuisance controls, mm-hmm. which again are unaffected by these changes.
Okay, thanks, Clare.
Okay, thank you. Willie and then Miles.
Thanks very much, Convener. Tom, I wonder if I could ask you two questions. Has the right of the public to participate in the decision-making process effectively been removed here? To grant street furniture outside hospitality and so on. Is that right to be part of that consideration being withdrawn?
Well, the important thing to bear in mind, it's not necessarily the case that street furniture would constitute development under planning, so it's not necessarily the case that there would be the decisions would be taken by either by a, I imagine, by delegated authority to officers or by a planning committee or a local review body within a local authority, as things stand at the moment. What is important to recognise, though, is that the views of the community would, of course, be taken into account by a local authority. And so where issues arise, whether that be around obstruction or impact upon areas pertaining to licensing or environmental health, that existing opportunity to make representations to the local authority and for the local authority to be able to take action under these separate statute provisions which are unaffected by the changes to permitted development rights, they still exist.
Applications coming forward that the Roads Department are about to consider, because otherwise the public wouldn't know.
Yeah, local authorities, this will be characterised differently in different local authorities, but it could be cafe permits, outdoor seating permits, things like that, or how different local authorities characterise it. And so, as Tom touched on, there's not a statutory requirement for local authorities, as roads authorities, to consult on this particular issue. They are at liberty to do so, and clearly where issues around impacting upon accessibility are identified by members of the public, they can make representations to local authorities through the usual channels, and local authorities are empowered to take action to address these issues should they choose to do so.
Okay. Another question is, should an issue arise where the public, after a facility has been installed and is operational, and the public still have issues and complaints with that. And you've made clear, Tom, that people can raise a complaint with the local authority about it. But supposing that is still a subject of dispute, what's the criteria that would apply there if the roads team, on the one hand, say it meets the specifications and the distancing and so on and so forth, but the public still have an issue with that, particularly people with disabilities? How is that to be resolved?
Well, these ultimately, of course, are going to be decisions for local authorities to take, just as decisions around planning applications will. Decisions around planning, for example, have to be taken in the context of the existing legislative framework. You know, does it accord with the development plan? Then it should go ahead unless material circumstances suggest otherwise, and vice versa. So ultimately, there is is incumbent upon local authorities or any public body to take into account the representations that are made, but it is still for them as the relevant body to determine what decision they want to take. What do you want to come in, Tom?
Just another point on that is that local authorities typically will grant consent under Section 59 for a time limited period. So if you look on local authority websites under the kind of roads permitting section, although as Mr. Arthur's touched on, it's sometimes referred to in different ways by local authorities as things like street cafe permitting. In almost all the examples I've looked at, it says this is granted for a temporary period, and that would allow, if issues arose, the consent would be time limited. The other thing is the PDR only applies to public roads, so that is roads owned by the Roads Authority. So you ultimately have the control of the authority owning the land itself. And so, you know, in extremis could withdraw its consent as the landowner to use that land in that way.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Camille.
Okay. Thanks. Miles.
Thank you, Official. I want to ask a couple of specific questions because I do think for many blind and visually impaired Scots, they are concerned about this, and certainly the charities have raised their concerns. And the fact there's no specific guidance attached to this, I think, is an issue, especially when you think of my own city here in Edinburgh during the festival, what that will look like for businesses potentially setting up just roped areas. And that's one of their main concerns. So I wondered why specific guidance hadn't been developed to go along with this so that councils would be able to really look at that in more detail of before this rolls out, especially in Edinburgh during the festival, for example.
Well, 2 points in responding to that, Mr Briggs. Firstly, we have sought to provide a significant amount of detail through the policy note, but secondly, to specifically address the point that you raised. Ultimately, the way in which street furniture is situated will be highly site-specific and it will be determined by the local context. So as such, guidance, if guidance is deemed to be something that would be desirable, would be better produced by a local authority reflecting this particular circumstances of their place. I believe that there's one local authority already has existing guidance, is at Aberdeen City. So there is that opportunity there for local authorities to, with their local place-based knowledge and understanding of particular circumstances, for example, the impact that the festival has in Edinburgh, to ensure that suitable advice or guidance is provided, if that is something that the local authority deems appropriate and proportionate, and ultimately that is a decision for the local authority.
Okay, thanks for that. I think one of the things in my time as MSP, it's what street furniture then starts to look like, and A-boards, things like that, especially during the festival, whether or not this relaxes that in many businesses' views as well, and how that will change. And I think, you know, people want to see assurance over how that will be enforced by the council at what could be an incredibly busy time with things going on. My other question was with regards to the electric vehicle charging infrastructure, and wondered what consultation had taken place with stakeholders, specifically Scottish Fire Service, and stakeholder groups around cladding on this.
Specifically, in terms of consultation, I referenced the 12-week consultation that we ran over the spring and summer of last year. With regards to any further details in the consultation, you want to pick up on, Tom?
I don't believe they responded to the consultation. What's the specific concern in respect of cladding? Is it cladding in respect to
the wider issue of attaching of electric charging points to buildings, and I wondered where consultation had taken place on them being freestanding under the changes, or whether or not this has actually been discussed with the Scottish Fire Service and stakeholder groups who are still currently undertaking significant work around cladding issues in Scotland.
I'm afraid I don't quite understand the connection to cladding. I mean, I think the point to make is there's already permitted development rights for freestanding EV chargers located in car parks across Scotland. What the changes do is allow larger equipment, including higher power EV chargers, to be installed under the PDR, so increase the height limit from the current, which is 1.6 metres to, I think it's 2.7, and allows that PDR to apply in a sort of wider range of car parks.
So my specific issue, and you know, where I think stakeholder groups would want to have been involved, is around proximity to buildings for these being installed and relaxed rules around that. And I'm not sure if that work's taken place from what I'm hearing.
Well, there has been, I say, there's been a 12-week consultation. This speaks to existing PDR being enhanced. It's also important, just to, this addresses some of the other points that have been raised, is that local authorities can, subject to confirmation by ministers, use an Article 4 process through the General Permitted Development Order, which can restrict or exempt particular areas from permitted development rights. I think that's an important thing to get on the record, because beyond the other consenting regimes that I've referred to,
in extremis, it can be if a local authority deems it as something that it would is required because of unintended consequences. There is a means there under existing provisions, as I say, subject to ministerial confirmation, to exempt a particular area from permitted development rights. And, Tom, I think it may be helpful if you can maybe just go over what it is the PDR that we're proposing do specific to EV charging infrastructure.
So there are existing permitted development rights at the moment. They've been in place since 2014. They allow for wall-mounted kind of plug socket-style chargers and EV charging upstands. The changes, well, at present, the PDI only apply in car parks, but not car parks located in certain designated areas, including kind of national parks, which, when you're thinking about sort of the range of electric vehicles, is a key consideration. The changes get rid of those restrictions where the car parks are in designated areas. They allow larger equipment, and they also make clear that the PDR cover the kind of supporting bits of equipment, kind of cabling and things like that, because I think from speaking to certain EV providers, there is a sort of aspect of doubt as to whether that kind of supporting kit that's actually necessary for the EV chargers to function, there's some doubt as to whether that was covered. We've also introduced a new PDR for kind of solar canopies that would provide power to chargers, I guess further increasing the kind of sustainability of the overall package. So that's the kind of summary of the changes.
And, you know, the wall-mounted charging specifically is the issue I'm concerned around and what this now presents. If I live in a block of flats and I have an electric car, can I then attach a charger without having any sort of proper pre-planning to that building?
I think that's already the case, and you know, I can recheck. I'm not aware that any concerns were raised through the consultation process about the sort of fire risks presented by wall-mounted chargers.
You know, I support the principle of what government's trying to achieve. I just think in terms of safety and the work of the Fire and Rescue Service and the stakeholder group around cladding at the minute and high-rise buildings, I'm not quite sure where direct engagement has taken place with them. Them knowing about this and responding is one thing. Whether or not they did, I don't... You suggest they haven't.
I think, but if I could interject, I think this is straining into the territory around, you know, equipment standards, and it's in a different sphere from what we're discussing here around planning. We have a long-established PD right, now 9 years old, with regards to wall-mounted EV charging infrastructure. The majority of this is actually focusing more on established parking areas and expanding capacity to reflect increased demand. But clearly, with regards to the installation on but commonly owned buildings, there's other aspects, you know, factors that come into play in a decision-making process around that, for example, regarding ownership of the building, etc. And as regards to the actual suitability or not of particular kit, that's something that is not within the safety of particular kit. Rather, it's clearly it's different, you know, regulatory regimes that cover that. And I think it's an important clarification to be made.
I accept that. I think some of the work, though, which the stakeholder group on cladding has been doing is specifically around proximity to buildings for electric charging points. And that is something which I am concerned about and not sure this necessarily captures or has specifically been considered.
As I would reiterate the point I made earlier, we have had a 12-week consultation. There has been that opportunity for engagement throughout the process, and we have not had any, to the best of my knowledge speaking here this morning, any specific concerns raised with regards to what has been proposed here. We have certainly, I'm not aware that we've had any specific concerns raised around the long-established PD rights that exist for EV infrastructure. Clearly, any stakeholders who would wish to engage with us, we are more than happy to do that and to consider any changes that would be required coming out of that. But we have had no concerns expressed to us directly, to the best of my knowledge, regarding the existing PD rights. Nothing through the consultation, to the best of my knowledge, has come up with the proposals around expanding PD rights for EV infrastructure. As I say, there are means by which should there would be a need to exempt any particular area of a planning authority from PD rights. There's a means to do that through an Article 4 direction. Of course, we continue to keep all legislation under review, and should any specific concerns be raised with us about planning provisions, then that is something that, of course, we would take on board very seriously and engage closely with. But as I say, it is not something that's been directly brought to my attention.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camilla.
Thanks, Miles. A couple of things. I just want to come back to the centres, 1B, and just to add into the mix that we've got our fantastic National Planning Framework 4, and that's kind of pointing us towards more town centre regeneration. And I think that's just something to keep an eye on, that as we try to retrofit houses and create more housing within town centres, we're going to add additional pressures. And Mark Griffin talked about families living nearby. So I think that's something just to keep an eye on, that if we move in that direction of travel in terms of how we want our town centres to regenerate, we're going to have more population and more activity in the streets. But I take on board your the mechanisms that you described in terms of being able to offer people a way to bring things to our awareness. I wanted to pick up on the 1C on port developments. And I've got some concern there because our papers mention green ports specifically, and those green ports are not in discreetly defined areas. There's a number of ports that come under certainly Edinburgh ports. And I'd be interested to understand a little bit more detail there, the order of kind of what's actually happening there. And again, it comes from a concern around the potential loss of community voice, both communities of interest, but communities of place, and how if something starts to happen, a development starts to happen that's affecting them, how do they actually have the recourse, the ability to raise that concern? So I'd be interested to know. So the order provides for development to be undertaken by the statutory undertaker's agents. Could you tell us a bit more about who these agents are?
Yeah, I'll ask Tom to come in a moment. I'll just say generally, these are fairly minor amendments, and they apply to all ports, not just aforementioned green ports. And they're really seeking to bring around parity with the PD rights regime that exists in England. But I'll ask Tom to respond to the detail.
I mean, yeah, as the Minister has said, these are sort of minor and technical changes that kind of are really about ensuring parity, kind of a level playing field between English and Scottish ports. The point around agent is really, again, to clarify that effectively it doesn't have to necessarily be the port operator itself carrying out the development. It could be a kind of contractor or agent working on its behalf, potentially a kind of tenant of the port operator.
That's very helpful. And I understand the desire is to have parity with what's going on in England, but we're also aware that there's some things going on in England that maybe we don't want to have parity on. So I think it's important to look at this. I'd be also interested to hear about what's going to happen if... So this is kind of... Is this expanding the ability to actually create non-port infrastructure?
The development has to be kind of operational development, so kind of connected to kind of port operations. So the works that could be carried out under the amended PDR are not especially significant, but would be things we spoke to kind of port operators and airport operators, airports being relevant here, because effectively the permitted development rights for airports and ports are very similar, and this kind of brings the wording into line, and therefore kind of engaging with some of the airport operators to kind of understand, well, this language around services and facilities, what kinds of development falls under that scope. And it's things like bus stops within the airport, and it's those kind of things that enable works that the undertaker is kind of, its statutory powers cover.
Okay, thanks for that. So you described something very specific there, bus stops, but what else could be brought in under this?
I mean, it's not defined. It's kind of services and facilities would cover a range of different things. I mean, something like bus stops, something like a toilet block, those kinds of operational facilities, but not kind of substantive new kind of development that, as you say, if it falls outside the permitted development rights, would be subject to a planning application in the normal way.
That's very helpful. Thank you for that. I just wonder if, you know, if there's something that's taking place in a green port, but also quite rightly in any port, in a town or a village even, that kind of starts to encroach on public interest and it sits within what this SSI is offering, this PDR. Sorry. What's the recourse there for community of place to have a voice?
I think for situations arise where, and this does happen with existing PD rights, whereby there's a view that perhaps the amenity of an area has been impacted negatively, or there are unintended consequences, or perhaps just given the nature of a particular area, an existing set of PD rights is not appropriate. There is, with the usual channels in mind, the means by which members of the public can make representations towards their local authorities. And I would bring it back, as I did previously with regards to the Article 4 direction, there is an opportunity for local authorities, with that confirmation from ministers, to restrict or indeed remove PD rights for a particular area. So that opportunity is there. It's not a case of we legislate for PD rights in Parliament and that's set in stone and cannot be changed other than through repeal of PD rights, you know, or amended instruments. There is that means there. And so that is just in terms of a reflection of how the planning system operates and how PD rights have operated for a number of years. So there is that means there, but one of the thing advantages with PD rights, and except they can be a bit of a blunt instrument, and there has to be consideration around how they're used, which is why we're taking this methodical, phased approach to PD rights. But what they can do is free up capacity within the planning system, where routine cases are no longer having to go through the planning system, which I recognise that the committee will have a keen interest in, particularly given the committee's keen interest on the issues around resourcing our planning system, which is going to be absolutely vital for delivering on the ambitions of NPF4s and the preparation of a new style local development plans, which will ensue over the next 5 years. So we always seek to take a balanced, proportionate approach to permitted development rights. That's why we're taking the phased approach, and we will continue to take a phased approach with PD rights. And indeed, later on, this year, we are aiming to move forward with the Master Plan Consent Area provisions within the 2019 Planning Act, which will create other bespoke opportunities to ensure that there's proportionate flexibilities to incentivise development and redevelopment that we want to see in not just our town centres, but in a range of settings, and which will be absolutely essential for realising the ambition behind NPF4.
Just one more thing on the kind of the port PDR. I think reflecting the fact that it is quite a broad permitted development right, there is a notification requirement so that the operator needs to notify the authority before carrying out development, which provides a mechanism for the authority if it was concerned that actually either that the works proposed didn't constitute development that was covered by the PDR, then they could say a planning application was required, or even indeed could say that the development was EIA development, and in which case the EIA environmental impact assessment provisions apply, which I think is again another important point with permitted development rights, that anything that's within scope of the environmental impact assessment regulations doesn't have PDR.
Okay, thanks very much for that. I think that's been helpful and clearly got some pathways back in case things start to go awry. I mean, again, it's I totally take on board the need to relieve pressure from local planning authorities, and nice to see that these measures do that, but I think we also need to make sure that we're keeping communities in mind at the same time. I don't think anyone's got any more questions. Oh, Mark.
Just a quick question, if that's okay. Thanks, Camilla. Just to ask, through the planning process, you have neighbour notification, so people who would be affected by a change would be proactively notified. But the other regimes that would remain in place, whether that's licensing or roads, there is no neighbour notification in those processes, are there? So we have a danger where people need to proactively seek out any changes that would be made rather than an authority notifying them. Is that the case?
Well, I think what is... I take the point you're making. What there will still be, what I would come back to in stressing as well, it may be the case that through the process of obtaining a permit, for example, for through the Roads Act provisions, is distinct from what would normally take place through the planning process. It's important to remember that it is not necessarily the case, I think, speaking to the point about street furniture, that it would always constitute development. So there could be scenarios taking place where street furniture, which is not constituting development, would not be subject to going through the planning system as things stand at the moment. But I'd want to just stress and reiterate that there is other consenting regimes there. They have to be adhered to. There's existing enforcement powers, and it is a means for people, members of the public, where they do think that an obstruction is taking place or that the amenity has been impacted through noise or nuisance, to seek remedy via the local authority, via these other regimes. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, Tom.
I think that's right, and you know, if and in the case of permitted development rights, as you've already touched on, the ability to use an Article 4 direction if permitted development rights were causing issues, then that's a mechanism to withdraw or restrict permitted development rights in particular locations.
I think this is, I think, and I would hope the committee has all agreed about what the intent behind this is, and wanting to create an environment that is supportive for our hospitality sector. And I would note the strong welcome that these proposals have had. But I recognise that there may be deemed by local authorities, based upon engagement with their communities, that the application of these PD rights to a particular area is not compatible with wider aims and concerns around the well-being and amenity of people living in a particular area. So these other mechanisms are there, both retrospectively, you know, through raising issues which can then be enforced through other regimes, but also for local authorities, as Tom says, to take a decision that actually they deem the application of PD rights for that particular area is not important, and they can seek to amend, restrict, remove the PD rate entirely for a particular area through that Article 4 order. So I would just want to stress that this will ultimately, as we introduce this, local authorities will monitor, and they will be able to, they will be best placed to make decisions based upon the impact. And where issues do arise, we've got a number of means by which to address them.
Thanks.
Okay. Thanks for that. I'm now going to briefly suspend. Thank you, Minister, for your patience with us. We've committee has discussed the various issues, and I think the two concerns that are we want to seek assurance, reassurance from you, are on a couple of points. So one on in 1A, on the electric charging points, we're aware that there's 105 buildings that are part of the cladding review process. And I think there's concerns about the wall-mounted EV charging points, if they are interacting with any of those buildings. Are you aware of that? And how can we handle that situation?
OK, I'm happy to go and take that away and look at it, but that speaks to existing PD rights which have been in place for the better part of a decade. This is primarily focused on existing parking spaces, enhancing capability. There's something that industry in the sector has been calling for, but as regards to being able to identify the existing number of EV infrastructure and chargers that are installed and you're on or in close proximity to buildings with cladding, I'm happy to take that away and ask relevant ministerial colleague to write back with the specific information if we hold that information on that.
So if you find that there's potentially going to be wall-mounted EVs on one or some of these 105 buildings, we can then look at maybe an amending order there. So I think there's great concern for safety.
The point I'm making is that if there is, it's because of the PD right that's been in place for 9 years. So it would be if there's a concern there, the local authority could seek for an Article 4 exemption, and that would be the means to go and do that. Or we could look at potentially beyond that if there is a need, but that would have to be, again, we've consulted at length, we've had no specific correspondence, to our knowledge on this, we've had nothing come up in the consultation, so we would need to go and look at the evidence base for why this should not be the case. And I'm conscious as well of other aspects, building standards, product safety, all pertain in this particular set of circumstances. So I'm happy to go away and look if there is anything around existing PD rights, but obviously the concern here today is with a package of PD rights of which EV infrastructure is a part. It's not introducing a new right around wall-mounted chargers. It hasn't already been in existence, I say, for the better part of a decade. But this package also includes a number of other measures as well. But as to whether or not we hold any specific information around the number of pieces of EV kit that are mounted on or in proximity to buildings with cladding, I'm happy to go away and see if we hold that information. If we do, to write back to the committee or ask the relevant minister to do so.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. And then on the town centre part 1B, I think there's this concern around the ability for the public to participate in anything that might affect their lives, and the removal of the neighbourhood notification. So could you give the committee some reassurance about how people could participate? I mean, I know we talked about I think the concern is that if a business brought forward the move to set up an outdoor seating area, that it's actually quite difficult for the public to find out that that's happening on their doorstep.
Is it a lot of quite a number of different scenarios of what we would think of in these circumstances, some table and chairs, etc., which we associate with these permitted development rights, already would not be captured as development. So as such, the appropriate regulatory provisions would be found within the Roads Act, in which case, if there's requirements for a permit, local authorities will define that permit in different terms, CAFE permit, pavement permit. And there's a means through that particular process for a decision to be made and indeed for enforcement action to be taken. So again, there is that means through, if there are issues around accessibility and obstruction identified, there's remedy available for the local authority to do that. And of course, local authorities are democratic bodies accountable to the people within their authority area. So I can give that reassurance, there's means there. And as I've said before, should any issues arise in any particular area as a consequence of these regulations coming into force through the Article 4 provision specifically, there is the means for local authorities with approval by ministers to exempt or restrict PD rights, to restrict PD rights in particular areas, or indeed to remove PD rights entirely for particular areas. So this is not something where, if a local authority finds itself in a situation where it has seen development take place, it would have required planning permission, but it's not requiring planning permission or planning application because of PD rights, it, they would have no recourse, as in something that would be centrally mandated and they couldn't change. Notwithstanding the provisions under the Roads Act, there would be the means to seek an Article 4 direction which could remedy the situation for them with the agreement of ministers.
Okay, thanks very much for laying that out. And actually, again, I mean, I think you touched on some of those things in your previous, in the earlier evidence session, but it's good to hear things again said in a slightly different way so the clarity starts to come through. I think we're also interested in hearing when you would be looking at reviewing this SSI, or how would you keep it under review, and, you know, if problems did start to arise, you know, what's the process for that?
Well, if the SSI comes into effect, it does so from the end of this month. I think we're approaching the end of the 40-day period. We will be continuing our phased approach to PD rights. We're hoping to commence phase three later on in the spring. But as part of our pivot to implementation and delivery post-adoption of NPF4, we're going to be having far closer engagement with planning authorities and a range of other stakeholders. So as part of the monitoring process for the implementation of NPF4, that will in itself also capture sort of broader monitoring of the implementation of a number of aspects of planning reform, of which PD rights is just one aspect. I touched earlier on that we're looking to commence other provisions within the Planning Act later this year, including around the master plan consent areas. So there will be that continuous close engagement with planning authorities, and that will really build on the collaborative approach that got us to the situation where we were able to command such overwhelming support for NPF4. And with the division pivoting into that collaborative approach towards implementation, monitoring will be a key part of that as well. So, as I say, that through our delivery programme for NPF4, which of course will be revised after 6 months and then yearly, through the various bodies that we engage with and the groups that we convene or co-convene on planning performance, and indeed in the Planning Infrastructure in Place Advisory Group, there will be a number of forums through which issues can be raised more widely on planning, but more generally just that culture of close engagement and partnership working with our planning authorities will mean that should any issues arise, they can be brought to attention at short notice, and we will, of course, where problems are identified, seek to remedy these problems. And whether that is can be done through, for example, Article 4 directions or amendments to the order, the 92 order overall, then, of course, we'll consider that. But things have to, of course, be proportionate and evidence-based, and we'll be able to establish any evidence base through that continued engagement.
Okay, thank you very much for that. It's good to hear the approach of continuous monitoring, certainly with NPF4 coming forward. There's going to be lots of changes, lots of moving parts to be keeping track of and how they interact with each other. So other members have any questions want to raise? Miles.
I welcome the constructive points you've suggested in terms of writing to the committee, but I'm still concerned with regards to electric charging points, and specifically the 105 buildings which still have to be surveyed. I was looking at the terms of reference for the cladding stakeholder group, but I don't believe they have a responsibility to take part in government consultations. So that's something which I think maybe the minister needs to take away and consider a conversation with them and the fire service, and whether or not he could commit to taking forward maybe an amending order on this to exempt these buildings during this period of time where they are still to be surveyed.
What I'm happy to give as an undertaking is to take away and to engage with the advisory group and relevant ministerial colleagues on this matter to identify if there are any issues of concern that have not been identified through the existing consultation. With regards to an amending order, I certainly do not rule that out, but I would clearly want to establish an evidence base in the first instance to do so. But as I say, I'm happy to ensure that we undertake that work and to write back to the committee to update. And of course, any further action that emerges out of that process, up to and including any changes to legislation, are of course can be considered a part of that process.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Okay. Mark.
I just wanted to put on record that I'm still concerned that there is a danger that, you know, a young family could essentially see an outdoor drinking area pop up outside a child's bedroom without the gold standard of a neighbourhood notification plan. There is no responsibility on a local authority to even consult when it comes to an application to a roads authority. So for me, there is still a real danger that things pop up in local communities that have a real impact on particularly young families that they have no prior awareness of. And for me, that's still a concern when it comes to this this instrument.
Okay. Do members have any other comments on the instrument? Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instrument? Obviously, we were seeking the reassurances that we've discussed, yes. Okay. I now suspend the meeting and to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much for spending this time with us and allowing us to go into detail in our scrutiny. The next item on our agenda today is an evidence session on community planning, hearing about the experiences of health and education community planning partners. This is the fifth session in our post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Act 2015. And the inquiry is looking at the impact of the Act on community planning and how community planning partnerships respond to significant events such as COVID-19 pandemic and the current cost of living crisis. And I just want to extend many thanks to our panel for joining us today. And we're joined by Craig MacArthur, who's the Director of Health and Social Care from East Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership, Alison McGrory, who is the Associate Director of Public Health at Argyll and Bute Health and Social Care Partnership, and online, we're joined by Alison McLeod, who's the Strategy and Transformation Lead from Aberdeen City Health and Social Care Partnership. And Alison, you can let the clerks know if you'd like to join a reply to a question by typing R in the chat function. And for Craig and Alison McGrory, you can just indicate to myself or the clerks. There's no need for you to operate your microphones, as we'll do that for you. And Annie Wells is going to begin our discussion today with some questions about the challenges that communities are currently facing.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Good morning, panel. I would like to specifically look at the health and educational inequalities that are faced in communities. And just to ask, what do you believe the community planning partnership's role is in tackling these issues? And I think if I could go to Craig first, maybe on this one, please.
Yep. Absolutely. So we have a real strength round about the education inequalities. So through the Community Planning Partnership, but also through our Children Young Person Strategic Partnership, which brings together a number of leaders from across those different sectors to consider and really understand some of the challenges that faces there in the first instance, but then put really good, robust plans in place to start to deliver against it. One of our main priorities round about, particularly in the education part of it, is about positive destinations. So as our young people work through school to ensure that as they do leave school, they do have a really good, strong, positive destination. We've seen that increase percentage-wise year on year for the last probably 5 or 6 years. We've seen some significant increases in there to the point where we're now one of the best performing areas round about positive destinations. And that isn't necessarily young people going on to college or university. It's making them ready for the world of work. And I think in terms of the health inequalities, how that education part then feeds into health inequalities, it's very much recognising that if we can get our young people into the world of work and sustain them there, the opportunities that brings round about actually reducing the health and other inequalities into to later life is absolutely the key to that success going forward. So we have a broad range of programmes associated with what we've badged as Caring for Ayrshire, which is about reducing health inequalities over the longer term. And that's not about investment just in traditional health and social care services. It's recognising the impact of good housing, the impact of education, the impact of employment, etc., and how that can then flow through into improving health inequalities into later life as well. So the work that we do around about that is absolutely key to this. So I think what we're seeing is the partnership working and bringing the key public sector partners together round the table has been really, really effective in doing that. A number of the key players in terms of the Ayrshire College, the Council, the Health Board, but also our other partners in terms of fire and police, who have a real strength round about pathways into employment, whether that be apprenticeships or graduate interns, and again, that real opportunity to encourage and support our young people through school and into the world of work.
Thanks very much for that, Kate. I don't know if Alison, if you get anything to add on that.
Yeah, I certainly would. And clearly all community planning partnerships have to have local plans, and health and education are visible within ours. So we've got 6 outcomes in Argyll and Bute. I think it's challenging in terms of impacting on inequalities because of the range of issues that we have. And I think looking through the community planning lens, it's about what difference do we achieve by coming together as community planning partnerships. And a lot of the work that we do, not necessarily in those two topics, health and education, but a lot of the work that we're doing, we would do regardless. So my speciality in public health is health improvement. And you can't do health improvement without working with other agencies and across agencies. So suicide prevention and child poverty action planning are really good examples of that, where there is added value from the community planning partnership. But that's work that we would do regardless in terms of improving outcomes. So I think there are challenges in terms of choosing some things that are achievable within a community planning setting and actually doing those well enough so that you can see a difference. And there's lots of really fundamental things that I hope I'll get the opportunity to come back and talk about in terms of how community planning partnerships could be strengthened and improved. So, yeah, I would completely agree with Craig that there's lots that we do in terms of impacting on education and health, but I think there's more that we could achieve.
Perfect. I don't know if Alison McLeod's got anything to add to that.
Yeah, thanks. Absolutely, I would agree with the previous two speakers. In Aberdeen City, we have 11 stretch outcomes in our local outcome improvement plan, and the various partners work together to deliver these. The outcome improvement group that I chair is around resilient, included and supported. So it's adult health outcomes in the main. We're looking at reducing or improving healthy life expectancy. And each of the projects within the stretch outcome is led by a community planning partner. So, for instance, our project around about suicide prevention is led by the police. We have our project that's around about carer support, which is led by Quarriers, who are commissioned carer support service. So it's all about that collaborative working, and you know, it's all about the priorities and the challenges that are common and shared to us all, because obviously there's a lot of inequality that is that impacts on health, and there's so many aspects to that that we need to work together to improve. So yeah, I think that, you know, the collaborative approach, the joined up working that community planning brings is absolutely key to that success. And I would agree with Alison, whilst we are doing a lot and we're achieving a lot, I think there's, you know, there are improvements that could be made and there's more that could be done.
Thank you very much for that, convener. I've just got one more question. I was looking at the submission from Glasgow Clyde College, where they said that previously staff from the CPP would visit community projects, but this no longer happens. And I was just wondering, in your respective areas, whether you think CPPs are ensuring that all voices in the community are heard, and in particular, including the communities of interest as well. And I don't know whether I'll go to Alison McLeod first online, if I may, Alison.
Yep, that's absolutely fine. And that was exactly one of the improvements that I was talking about. That you know, I think in our those who are participating in our community planning, particularly from the communities themselves, tend to be a restricted group. They tend to be older, perhaps retired professionals in the main. And we are definitely missing the voices, particularly of younger people, and particularly from those seldom heard groups. And we are looking at the way we're doing things at the minute, thinking rather than expecting people. We have locality empowerment groups, which we had originally intended to be the focus for all our engagement and participation. But we've realised that's only one method that we can use now, and that we have to perhaps go out into those groups of, you know, the communities of interest, rather than asking them to come and participate in another group. You know, we need to go to them, and we need to find some way to link in with the existing groups that are already out there, and try and maximise the opportunity that's there.
Thank you. I don't know if Alison, you want to come in next? Yeah.
I think this is hugely challenging, and I think the way they're set up, the bureaucracy round about how committees are run, because of the locus of control with local government having that responsibility to deliver them, that brings with it that bureaucracy into how our meetings are run and delivered. And even by having meetings in the evening and at different times of the day, I agree with Alison in terms of it does tend to be people who've got time on their hands, so retired people, older people in our communities who are really valid in terms of being at community planning structures, but they aren't always representative of the whole community. And we don't necessarily ask our representatives to canvass their wider community, and we don't have the structures in place so that they can canvass the views of other people. So I think this is a really, really important point in terms of how we agree what the outcomes are going to be and how we then invest in delivering those outcomes if we don't have that democracy in terms of who all attends and participates in community planning structures. I feel our meetings are really formal. I only really got the experience in my own board area in NHS Highland, so I can't really comment on other areas, but we try our best. So we bring in some of our community groups and we bring in our MSYPs, but we still have the formality in terms of agendas and minutes and how our meetings are recorded. So I'm a real advocate in terms of a health improver about how we build capacity and invest in our local structures and free the reins. And they probably wouldn't understand community planning in terms of what the Act requires of it, but they understand and get what it means to be, able to come together and make their communities better and be empowered to take things forward and make a difference in their local community. So I think we do need to cut away some of that bureaucracy. Thank you.
Thanks, Alison. Craig, if you would like to come in on that one as well, please.
Absolutely, yeah, thank you very much. So I think for us, in terms of the formality around about the community planning meetings, I would agree that there is a certain formality around about them, as there probably has to be. But I think in terms of the engagement to get to that point, we're really keen that we do meet with some of the groups that are not necessarily part of the Community Planning Partnership Board. So I think we've talked around about young people. So we have a joint session every year where we meet with our Children and Young Persons Cabinet and the MYSPs as well. So they'll come along and take that opportunity to really have a real good, strong engagement with them around about their priorities and what we as a Community Planning Partnership Board can do to support delivery of them together alongside them. Our community plans get three sort of themes round about it, so I'm responsible for delivery of the wellbeing delivery aspect of it in terms of how that sits across health and social care. And we've just recently finished some local conversations. We've actually went out into our communities and met with people, so we had three local conversations across different community areas, and those are really fascinating sessions. So one of them, we had the good fortune, is actually on a Friday, part of a long weekend where the schools were off, so there's lots of mums but young kids had come along as well, which totally changed the dynamic of how that event went compared to the next week where it was all people who the typical the grey suits, the folk who normally engage, and the feedback from each of those sessions was fascinating, very, very different. But just taking those opportunities to engage in a different way, I think for me is key about how we start to really hear those voices and make sure we can take those different agendas forward in a different way. The other set of groups that we do have on our Community Planning Partnership Board, so we have four representatives from the community sector sit on our board, two from community councils and two from community-led action plan steering groups. So we do hear the voice of communities in there, and we also have two representatives from the voluntary sector, as well as two from the Chamber of Commerce. So we get the business voices in there as well. So we do get quite a wide range of voices at the Community Planning Partnership Board. But the big gap, I think, in there is the voice of the young person, and those other ranges that we have in place very much allows us to fill that gap.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you very much, convener.
Thank you. Thanks for that. And yeah, good to hear actually different approaches there. And I keep wondering if we need to a way to include young people is to actually make this kind of community planning something that's actually in the school curriculum, so that young people who are studying maybe a higher could be part of a community planning partnership and weighing in on that thing. But I'm kind of digressing. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's got the theme of community empowerment.
Thanks, Kabina. So we're considering a review of the Community Empowerment Act, and for me, at the most basic level, the question I have is, since the introduction of the Act in 2015, has community participation improved at all? Has the Act had any meaningful impact on community participation? And do you have anything to evidence any increased levels of participation? I'll come to Alison McGrory first.
Yeah, I think it would be quite hard. I mean, again, I'm talking from my own personal experience as a public health professional. So you know, if you were to ask somebody else in my community planning partnership in Argyll and Bute, they might have a different view, but I'm not entirely sure that we're making a difference. And it's not just about legislation in terms of community empowerment, although that is clearly really important. And there's a clear rationale in terms of the Christie Commission. And then before that, you know, some of the seminal work that grounds us in public health, which is the Ottawa Charter for Health Promotion, which is about empowering and enabling people so that then improves their health and wellbeing outcomes. So that's really robust and really clear. But there needs to be, to support that, there needs to be a rebalance in terms of power and how we redistribute investment. And I don't think that's necessarily there. And that there, you know, there's a lot of bravery that's required in terms of going down that route. But if you want communities to come together meaningfully to make a difference, it needs to be more than the goodwill of a partnership where there isn't any money and there isn't any accountability. So the locus of control in terms of health and social care is through health and social care partnerships, the statutory bodies and the parent bodies of NHS boards and local authorities. So it's quite a difficult one in terms of what difference does it make because of that accountability resting with the statutory bodies and the goodwill of community planning partners. And there is a lot of goodwill and a lot of really good work that comes, but I think for me personally it's about how we shift that locus of control into communities if we really want to see a difference in terms of empowering communities to improve all of the outcomes.
Okay, thanks. Craig?
Thank you very much. So I think we have seen significant changes in terms of what we see working in East Ayrshire since the Act came into being. So maybe three specific examples round about community asset transfer and some of the assets from the council transferring across into community ownership or lease arrangements, etc. So I think we, as of last week, have probably about almost 60 effective community asset transfers that have now taken place. I think one was returned back to the council and very quickly was retransferred again. So I think the initial concerns were community asset transfers might go out, but they're very quickly come back because the community would feel round about it. We've not seen that at all. The one that came back wasn't a favour, it was just a change of circumstance that caused it to be reconsidered. So as I said, those community asset transfers, almost 60 of them, really, really effective. We also have community-led action plans across 23 of our communities. So this is where people come together as a community. They set out their own aims, objectives and actions and what they want to see improved within their own community. So this isn't led or driven by the council. It's very much the facilitated by us, but the communities themselves come together to deliver that. Requires a 40% uptake. So the communities are asked, there's questionnaires, surveys issued, and the only way they can actually take this forward is if they get a 40% return rate. So there is real buy-in from the local communities to take that forward. And the final example in there is just round about participatory budgeting, and we've done several of those events, the last one of which was through my own services in terms of wellbeing, ran last September-ish time. A number of events that took place across different areas, over 1,000 participants, people coming together to vote on what they seen as the priorities for spending that money. It was around £250,000 of wellbeing monies to be spent in local areas. As I say, over 1,000 participants, which was just brilliant, and the feedback from that is that when will the next one be, because people are absolutely enthused by it, not just because it's an opportunity to get some money, but I think the actual coming together, the sharing stories with people, is the feedback we're getting was absolutely priceless. So some really good success stories for us.
Okay, thanks, Craig. And Alison McLeod, don't know if you've got anything to add.
Yeah, absolutely. So I would say participation did sort of ramp up over the years since the Community Empowerment Act was introduced. I think prior to the pandemic, we had roughly 300 community members participating in our locality empowerment groups. But I don't think we can underestimate the impact of the pandemic over the last 3 years in that participation. So I would say that kind of has paused and halted the progress that we were making, and we're now in the process of trying to recover from that, but it will take us time, I think, to get back up to the participation levels that we had before. But I think we shouldn't underestimate, you know, that the communities are being asked to do a lot You know, we often hear about that consultation fatigue, you know, and you, some people are telling us, you know, don't come and ask us again what we want because we're fed up telling you. So what we are trying to do in Aberdeen is be more joined up. So we have joined up our community plan or our locality planning arrangements between the Health and Social Care Partnership and the local authority. So that the locality empowerment groups cover the whole range, not just the health agenda, but the whole range of the local authority priorities as well. So we're trying to coincide those priorities and streamline the processes and the means for people to come forward and engage, make it as easy as possible for them.
Okay, thanks for that. My second question is just on level of awareness in the community of community planning partnerships. I suppose I'll come to you first, Craig, just to ask, do you think the community is broadly aware? Are they aware that community planning exists? Are they aware what it does? And are they aware how to get involved?
I suspect the answer to that would be no. In terms of, if you couch the question that way, in terms of do you know what a community planning partnership is, I think the answer would probably for the vast majority would be no. I think if you described it round about community-led action plans, participatory budgeting, some of the good stuff that we have seen happening round about community empowerment and how the communities can be involved, I think most of our communities would absolutely recognise that. I think they do see the opportunities to get involved in it and to really make a difference within their own communities. But I think if you couch it in those sort of statutory terms round about what the Community Empowerment Act talks about, I don't think people would recognise that in there. So I think that's some of the challenges for us, is about how do you actually have those conversations in a different way so that our communities do understand what we're trying to achieve and what contribution they can make to that. So I think that language is really important here. How we couch it, the terms that we use is absolutely critical. But I say, I think in terms of your specific question, if we asked our communities those specific questions, I suspect the answer for the majority would be no, they don't understand that, they don't think it happens here, and they really don't see how they can take it forward. But when you get into the detail around about it, I think you get a very different response.
Okay, thanks for that. Come to Alison McLeod and then Alison McGrory.
Yeah, I would agree that there will be limited awareness of the structure of community planning. But I think if you were to ask our communities, they would say that yes, we do come and we engage with them. We ask them to participate in various things, such as, you know, some of the commissioning that we do. So yeah, it is about semantics. It is about language, and I guess again, a lot of our community representatives are really not interested in the structure or the framework that's around it. What they're most interested in is that we come out and speak to them, and that we listen to them, and deliver what they're looking for.
Thanks. Alison.
I don't have an awful lot to add to that. I suppose engagement goes to the heart of public health, and it is a challenge in terms of the common voices and the seldom heard voices, and we have to work harder to engage the seldom heard voices. Yesterday, for example, I had an event in Dunoon round about the model Getting It Right for Everyone, which is an aspirational model for adults, modelled on GIRFEC for children. And so we had 20 people that turned up. So these are generally people are fairly engaged in terms of local community activity. And I did a bit of canvassing in terms of their understanding of community planning in advance of coming here today. And there was a good level just in that small cohort. But conversely, I had a family party on Saturday and again told friends and family that I was coming here, and really there was a very low level of understanding about community planning. So, you know, I think generally that is probably more representative than the people who I was engaging with yesterday for the purposes of health and social care. So I think that's a challenge, and I completely agree with you, Craig, in terms of, so they understand, people understand about what makes their community strong and vibrant and how it can be better. But, you know, when we talk about community empowerment legislation, they don't get that.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Cumin.
Thanks, Mark. I'm just going to say that we're a bit short on time because of previous business going over. So, colleagues, if you can roll your questions into one where that makes sense and possible, and I'd invite our guests to... we definitely want to hear from you, but if you're if something's already been said, you get the point. Thanks very much. It's a challenging morning here. So we're now going to move on to the theme of the role of the third sector and communities with Paul McLennan.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, just talking about the role of the third sector and communities, and it's around about the experience of the local organisations, primarily, in, I suppose, in your remit, and looking at probably the strategic planning board, but also at themed levels, and you know what you feel their involvement is at this stage. And I'm probably going to come to Alex McLeod first of all, because Alex, one of the key things you'd said in your response to the evidence was you would like to see a strategic shift to embrace community-led action. So how do you almost get the community's involvement, if you like, or the third sector involvement in the discussions to make it relevant and move towards that strategic shift that you mentioned in your evidence? So, Alison McLeod, I'll come to yourself first of all on that one.
Yep, thank you. So, first of all, just to say that our third sector interface organisation, Aberdeen Council for Voluntary Organisations, is very involved in all of the work that we do. We try and go through them and use them as much as we can to interface with community organisations and the voluntary sector in particular. And they're engaged in a lot of our groups. So they're on our strategic planning group, they're on our strategic commissioning and procurement board. We just try and link in as much as possible. We also have community representatives on our strategic planning group. When we undertake commissioning, etc., we involve people there so that we're really looking at that co-design and co-production. And I would say in terms of achieving that strategic shift, that we're looking at that as a long game. You know, we're looking at it, we're chipping away at it, we're doing bits where and when we can. And I think we certainly have some evidence around about what we've achieved. But there's a long way to go, and it's hard work, and we just need to keep at it and keep trying.
Come to the Alison McCrory.
Yeah, just a really quick response. We work very closely with the third sector interface, and they sit around the table, and there are community members in our area, community planning groups, and on the management committee. Again, in terms of how representative they are, if we think about the challenges within the third sector in terms of delivering their services and all of the ongoing fundraising that they have to do, and very often these are services that have year-to-year funding streams, so that's a real challenge for them. And that doesn't always allow them capacity to do what they maybe see as a bit of an add-on and a nice-to-do in terms of coming and participating in community planning.
I think that's a really important point, Alison. Thanks for that. Craig?
Yep. Thank you very much. So, similar to others, we do that representation I mentioned before, actually on the Community Planning Partnership Board, so we do get the voice of the third sector, both at that and at our Executive Officer Group as well, and through our Strategic Planning and Wellbeing Delivery Group, that's co-chaired by myself and the Vice-Chair of the IGIB. Again, third sector interface representation in all of these groups. A year ago from now, March last year, we created what we called a partner provider statement that all of the local bodies that deliver services on our behalf signed up to. That's about collaborative commissioning, and it's a range or a set, a suite of collective beliefs that talks about how we celebrate success together in terms of what we're delivering, and it also identifies those opportunities to improve and work together in partnership and collaboration. And it's to try to move away from having the third sector almost in competition with each other, because there's lots of bodies there all fighting for the same pots of money. So it's to try and really encourage them to work together, to deliver services together for the benefit of our communities in terms of what we're trying to do as a health and social care partnership. And that, to me, has been really, really effective.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Paul. I'm now going to bring in the local outcome improvement plans and locality plans theme. And I was interested to hear, Alison McLeod, about your awareness in Aberdeenshire around the consultation fatigue, and that you've joined up locality plans so that you've got coinciding priorities and streamlined processes. And because we're also aware of the issue of the potentially cluttered landscapes of so many plans, I'd be interested to hear about from all of you about the LOIPs and the locality plans, how they're working, and in particular I think CPPs have been set up to take that preventative approach. So are these plans, these strategic plans, helping us get to achieve that outcome? So maybe I'll start with Alison McLeod.
Yeah, so in Aberdeen City, the local outcome improvement plan is the paramount plan. So our strategic plan, for instance, for the Health and Social Care Partnership is linked, absolutely linked directly to that. And any projects that we have within the stretch outcomes of the local outcome improvement plan are totally reflected in our strategic plan. So we're not duplicating resource, we're not duplicating effort, and we're seeing that full alignment. And one of our strategic aims in our strategic plan is prevention, and a lot of the projects within the local outcome improvement plan are around about that prevention agenda. And NHS Grampian are around about that as well, with their plan for the future. The various planners in each of the organisations, we have joint meetings, we discuss our approaches, we discuss, we try and do a joined up consultation where we can to inform our planning processes. So we're it's a bit of a journey, I have to say. I mean, we're at the beginning of that journey, and I think you know our most recent plans are probably quite reflective of that joined up and collaborative working. But we've still got some way to go. But we've started that snowball now, and hopefully that will keep rolling along and getting bigger and trying to bring all these strands together and you know just have that one landscape.
Thanks very much for that. Yeah, it sounds like clarity is really important. Alison McGrory, how's it going in Argyll and Bute in terms of the LOIPs and the locality plans?
Yeah, I feel I've got a lot to say about this and maybe the time won't do it justice. Again, I think in Argyll and Bute Community Planning Partnership, we do what the legislation and the guidance tells us to do. So the guidance tells us that we have to have LOIPs. These LOIPs are needs-based, so these needs are deficit-driven. So what is the problem? What is our response to addressing that problem? And if you flip that around, I'm not sure if all the panel members will be familiar with the term assets-based community development. So that's good. Yeah, so that's where we know in terms of what is strong in a community and how can we make that stronger and empower and build from the strength rather than from that deficit. So that's quite a flip. And that doesn't assets-based community development. We can do it and do it to the best of our abilities, but it doesn't fit within what the guidance for community planning is asking us to do. So I think that's a paradigm shift and probably a big meaty one for this panel to consider. There's another aspect in terms of, so Christy recognised we needed to be better at performance. Now, 12 years on, the industry that we have around about performance, I can honestly say often for my team in public health, we're doing the performance reporting to the detriment of doing the work that we should be reporting on. And, you know, again, I think just some common sense round about that in terms of how we can simplify that. So, yes, we clearly have to ensure that we're justifying that we're doing the right things and what is the output and we're seeing the difference of that, but not to the point of generating this huge complexity of performance outcome matrices and frameworks and all of the rest of it that you'll be very familiar with.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. Craig?
Yeah, but without repeating everything that the two Alices have already said, but we're just building on that last point round about having to produce the data, the stats. We know that we need to produce that in terms of the legislation, so the LOIP has to contain particular things. I think what we've deliberately have tried to do is to go into storytelling mode, use case studies and actually describe what's happening, describe the outcomes and actually show what difference this is happening in real life to people and to communities. So the narrative is, I think, is that almost going back to the picture tells a thousand stories, etc. I think those stories for us are much more important than the stats, and I'm really keen that For all of our performance reporting, that's very much the direction of travel for us. So it's telling the stories, the real life, the living experience and the impact of what we're doing is actually having on people. So I think that's how we're trying to address some of those challenges around about probably quite a rigid system round about this is what you need to report against, but recognising that the wee bit of flexibility we do have round about the edges is where we can start to make a real difference in terms of that storytelling. And really, again, if we're talking about our communities not recognising community planning, when you start to tell those stories, that's where you can really engage with our communities and have them understand the impact and the work that is actually taking place and how it's delivering change within their local areas.
Thanks for that. Yeah, storytelling makes things so much more accessible, doesn't it? Alison McCrory, I just wanted to come back to you on that assets-based versus deficit-based. So you were talking about the Community Empowerment Act provides guidelines on the approach. Is there not flexibility within... I mean, my understanding of guidelines is that they're guidelines and they're not a kind of like, you must do it this way. So do you not feel that there's flexibility within those guidelines to actually move to an assets-based approach? Because, you know, I think that's a really good point of building on what's already working. So I'm just wondering if there's any scope there, or do you feel like it actually needs to be something in legislation that needs to be reviewed?
I was thinking about this a lot yesterday. Yeah. I'm not sure. It is quite a fundamental shift, and we do it as best we can within that paradigm of health and social care services are there to provide services for people who need them. And we know that if we get upstream, we can do lots to prevent services, but we're funded and resourced to do the delivery in the here and the now. So it's almost like in parallel, you need to build up that prevention response. And, you know, we're really clamouring for that just now in terms of the impacts both of COVID and all of the social determinants of health and the sustainability of services. And for example, where I am in Argyll and Bute, it's not just simply about money, it's about how we can bring people in to fill jobs that we want to appoint to. So the assets-based approach is a paradigm shift, and I think there needs to be something, clear expectations, so whether it's legislation or whether it's guidance, I'm not entirely sure, but I think to enable that paradigm shift, there needs to be something fundamental that changes to enable us to go down that route, because it's just so easy to do a needs assessment. So what does the quantitative data tell us in terms of what the problem is? What does the evidence say in terms of what the response is? What do we then do and then continue to measure that problem to see if it's reduced? And very often it doesn't reduce because it's within the context of demographic change or other factors. So mental health improvement is a prime example of that, where the traditional response is about delivering more services, so more of the same in terms of counselling services or that type of response to what the problem is, rather than the preventative, what keeps people mentally well within communities. So we know that in terms of all of the social determinants of health. So a good income, good housing, good jobs, all of those social determinants of health are protective in terms of mental health improvement, rather than that downstream response. So when people are in distress, what we need to do in terms of counselling or whatever other services.
Okay, thanks very much for that. It was helpful. I'm going to move on to Marie McNair with the theme of measuring impact.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'll start with Alison McLeod online. Do you feel that CPPs are able to demonstrate the impact they have, and do you feel that CPPs are making a difference? And if they are, what examples would you highlight as their success?
So I think it's, first of all, to say it's probably difficult to measure some of the differences that is being made. I would say we are making a difference. I'll just go back to the projects that we have against each of our stretch outcome. Each of these projects start with a project charter, which lays out the aims and it lays out how we're going to measure. So we start with our baseline measures, where we are, and we state our intention as to where we want to be. So for the suicide prevention, we've got the number of suicides that we had in our area last year, and we set a target to reduce that, and we monitor those numbers and we report on those numbers. So we can measure differences, but some of the changes that we're trying to make, as I say, are long-term goals, in terms of changing behaviours, in terms of making an impact on healthy life expectancy. So, you know, that's not something that we can measure over the very short term of a project. But we will keep those measures, and you know, we have our outcome measures that we will continue to monitor as the years go by, and we'll be able to demonstrate the difference that's being. But we do employ an improvement methodology, and we do small tests of change, and only if those small tests of change work, then we scale that up to the wider areas. So I think the approach that we've got sets out a means of us being able to demonstrate what we do, and a means of being able to identify those projects that are, or that activity that is worth taking forward and committing resource to and scaling up to make that bigger difference.
Thanks for that. Craig, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I suppose I kind of answered the last question round about storytelling. So I think, again, for us, I think some of that is round about this question as well, telling those stories and really describing to people what it means in terms and sort of case study type approaches in ways that they would understand. I think for us, the bit in here, the key in here to actually demonstrating success going forward is making good use of data. So we are becoming increasingly data-informed. The intelligence that we have round about that is really, really crucial. I think as we become more effective in terms of partnership working across agencies, the ability to share data across agencies becomes more and more critical as well. That can sometimes be quite challenging. So we share data for particular circumstances, for particular reasons sometimes, but if you want to do it for different reasons, you need to go through a whole new approach in terms of that information sharing protocols, etc. So the GDPR impact round about information and data sharing can sometimes be quite challenging. But the opportunities round about it are endless, and if we can get that nut cracked, there are some real things, real opportunities to do things in a different way by better use of data and sharing that information. In terms of making a difference in some specific examples, we've got some good examples around about suicide as well, as Alison described, so I won't talk about that, but we recently developed what we've called our HEART wellbeing model. So HEART stands for Help Everyone at the Right Time. This is about children's wellbeing services, and again, it goes right across a whole range of different statutory and third sector partners, and that's proven to be really, really effective. We've done some really good work around about addiction support, so rapid access to drug treatment, 24-48 hours, called RADAR, and also some peer recovery workers that we've managed to deploy into some key areas as well. Again, some real success stories round about that. Probably the most recent one round about cost of living, the response to cost of living crisis, and the use of our financial inclusion resources. So we've grown that in recent years. So we now have financial inclusion support working within our secondary schools, but supporting the broader cluster. We've got financial inclusion support within our DPEN GP practices, funded through the Scottish Government. But again, that's having a real impact. And those same financial inclusion teams working within the court, working with closely by Macmillan for people suffering from cancer in terms of the impact we can have in there, and also quite recently starting to deploy financial inclusion resources within our health visiting teams, so actually getting into families at a very early stage when they've just got young children and starting to make a real difference in there. So that's having a huge impact in terms of what we do as a service, but it's also putting a lot of money into people's pockets, which is allowing them to be much more resilient and respond to challenges themselves as well. So some real good successes in there for us.
Thank you. Alison, do you have any
ones? Yeah, just one or two. So I think we've got really strong cohesion in terms of partnership working, and that brings itself to how we then have leadership round about delivering certain strategies. So we talked about the Child Poverty Plan. I'm really proud of the work that we have with the Child Poverty Plan, also the Children and Families Strategy that I'm not sure if it's the same cycle, but we're in the process of updating our Children and Families Strategy in Argyll and Bute, and also our Living Well Strategy, which is about supporting people with long-term health conditions, and also the primary prevention aims in terms of preventing the occurrence of long-term health conditions. So lots of strengths in that. And I think a couple of particular things in terms of some of our aspirations round about joint engagement approaches. So health and social care has got statutory responsibilities to engage effectively with communities. And there's lots of cross-fertilisation and cross-learning and going out collectively to communities, so rather than in parallel, and asking lots of different questions about different things. So I think there's synergies and successes there. And one last one round about our community, our equality impact assessment, where we now have a unified impact assessment process for equalities, and that includes the island impacts, because we've got 23 inhabited islands in Argyll and Bute. So that's now routinely used in terms of impacting or reducing the impact of equalities.
Thanks, Alison.
Thanks, Marie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs with the theme of culture of public bodies.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. I think it's been quite refreshing and honest what we've heard in terms of where you think the public are in this, but I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to how this has changed organisations and bodies itself. And in answer to my colleague Mary McNairn, you've touched on that already in working with third sector and outside organisations, but I wanted to ask specifically with regards to resources and budget allocation, how that's potentially changed and you've seen, because I think for most groups we've spoken to, it comes down to who then pays for the delivery, and if you have any examples of what that's looked like and how CPP's helped change that resource allocation. Craig, I'll maybe start with you.
Yeah, thank you very much. So, I think I mentioned at the start, within our community plan, we have three specific themes round about it. So, round about wellbeing, round about economy and skills, and the third one, round about safer communities. And there's a lead officer assigned to each of those. So I lead the wellbeing part of it from within health and social care. Our chief education officer leads the economy and skills one. And one of the local senior police officers leads the safer communities. So we do have a real strength in terms of who's taking the work forward. So it's already deployed out to community planning partners. We come together regularly in terms of an executive officer group just to discuss resources, etc., and what decisions we are taking and how that might impact on partner bodies as well, just to have that really close understanding. And once a year, which happened just a few weeks ago, we come together to have a closed-door budget session where we really have a kind of warts-and-all discussion round about where we are as individual organisations in terms of budget settlements, savings we might need to make this year, and making sure there's no adverse impact. So there's almost that consequential impact of a decision that's taken over here might make a saving for you, but it might actually push more work further downstream or upstream. So we're really, really, really careful around about those consequences in there. So that's proven to be really, really effective. I've probably had that for the last 5 or 6 years now, having those really detailed budget discussions. And from that, that then sort of sometimes helps to inform different decisions that you then present to Cabinet or to Council in terms of a Council position in terms of the budget decision making. I think we've had a few new members join the Executive Officer Group recently, so a new members coming that perhaps got experience of other community planning partnerships, and I think, albeit very new in the door, I think they do recognise the strength and maturity that we have as an Executive Officer Group, particularly in terms of that really good, robust decision-making process, particularly around about resourcing and finances. So while we won't necessarily pool budgets and do things in a really joined-up way by putting money together, what we make sure we don't do is take decisions that only impacts on one part. There does a real joined-up, a real synergy around about the decision-making at every step along the way. So that is really helpful for us.
Yeah. Alison, do you have anything you want to add?
Yeah, I'm quite thoughtful about this. Again, I think it comes back to the limitation of community planning partnerships, and there's not really that locus of control in terms of the governance that community planning partnerships don't have a say in how statutory bodies allocate the resources, so there may well be, and it's really interesting to hear what you're saying, Craig. I think that comes from the goodwill, from the strength of partnership working, rather than from the guidance of what community planning should achieve. So I'm really, really unsure about that one. And if I can give you the example of climate emergency, where in our CPP, like everybody, we're recognising the importance of considering what our response is round about that, what influence we can have, what we can deliver on that, and we've been looking for a really small pot of money, and it's been really hard to get that together in terms of employing one development officer to take us forward over the next 2 or 3 years. We've put a bit in from public health, but it's a hard one. And in parallel, I think it's important to flag up the work that is happening in relation to community wealth building legislation. So, I, you know, a lot of things come out for me in an operational capacity. They come out in parallel. So maybe for people in Parliament or within the government, they are joined up, but it doesn't always feel like that when it reaches me in terms of how I then put that into practice and in terms of delivering what I need to do with my team and then reporting back. And I think we should be having really important conversations around about community wealth building. And what I did for the response for this committee was form a focus group in December, and that is my intention, that I'll do a focus group with similar people around about a response for community wealth building, and it overlaps with this.
That's helpful, thank you. And online, Alison, did you want to come in on this? Or
Just it's similar to Craig. The structure that we have in Aberdeen lends itself to encouraging participation and resource in terms of personnel and staff coming forward and getting involved in the projects and leading the projects. We try to make sure that those who are chairing the outcome improvement groups and vice chair, etc., come from a spread across the partners. So the structure certainly lends itself to encouraging that participation and that resource in terms of people, as I say. But in terms of budget, in terms of money, that it's not really the same. It is just that resource in terms of people that is allocated to that. But what I would say is some of the outcomes from some of the projects that have taken place have helped inform some budget decisions for some of the partners, because that evidence is there that if we put in a bit of resource to make that difference, then, you know, in order to scale that up, that might need some investment. So it's helping to inform budget decisions rather than us pulling budgets to deliver things.
Yeah, that's helpful. And I think, you know, capturing resource in kind is quite difficult sometimes as well to then quantify a financial figure to that. But thanks very much. Thanks, Carmina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to move on to our final theme, which is local and national leadership, with Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to you all. We've heard contrasting evidence at the committee about the success or otherwise of the CPPs right across Scotland, and probably the key role that leadership plays in driving the CPPs forward. So just a couple of questions. I'll roll them all into one if I can for you. Do you recognise leadership as a key driver in your local authority area in making the CPPs succeed? Is that leadership shared amongst the partners in the CPP, or is it very much still driven by the local authority officials, do you think? And maybe lastly, have you any recommendations or comments on the national guidance and the statutory bodies that actually participate in the CPPs? But principally, what do you think, what does leadership look like and what makes a successful CPP? I'll start with you, Craig, seeing as you're East Ayrshire.
Thank you very much. So is leadership important? Absolutely. I think it has to be. For all that we do, leadership is always going to be important. So it remains, I think, of critical importance. And I think in terms of the community aspect round about this, I think if we are serious, however we couch it, whether it's about the formality round about community planning or the reality of what people actually recognise by it, I think having really strong leadership round about it is key to making that successful. For us, we know that the council has a statutory role round about taking the lead role in terms of community planning, but at a very local level, it's not left to the council just to get on with it. So while the council leader will chair the community planning partnership board, and that's fine, that always happens, there is really good engagement from all the other statutory bodies round the table and all the other members of the community planning partnership board at an officer level in terms of the engagement there and leadership there. Really good, strong engagement again from chief executive levels across all of those partner organisations. An executive officer group, the chair rolls round about those different groups as well. So our local fire commander has just recently demitted the chair. I've taken it on, and next year it will move on to the local police commander. So we do see that kind of the partnership leadership role absolutely being to the fore in there, and it is really, really important. So I think not to underestimate the importance of leadership. I think we are very fortunate, and certainly in East Ayrshire, that the local leadership round about it are very, very keen to take it forward. I think everybody recognises the community plan is almost a sovereign plan that sits above all of the individual partner local plans as well. So we're all sort of singing to the same tune there, and it's absolutely apparent in all the meetings that we do attend. In terms of statutory bodies and whether or not we want to see that changing in terms of the legislation, I think the flexibility that we've currently got in there, so I think we go beyond this. So the statutory requirement means there's certain people have to be involved in it. There's a flexibility to engage beyond that as well, which we do. We take that opportunity to engage beyond it, which I think is helpful. I think to specify and be really rigid around about who should be on a community planning partnership board wouldn't be helpful. I think the local flexibility is something that we absolutely welcome, and recognise that by bringing on the right people, we do see the merits and the benefits from that. But to start to prescribe it within legislation, I don't think would be helpful. Beyond what we've already got in there.
Thank you, Craig. Alison?
I think about being driven by local authorities, that's a no and a yes, and I already answered that question in relationship to the bureaucracy that local authorities lend to it. Like Craig, we've got really good leadership from police, fire, health, local authority, and we have had a rotating chair. We don't have coterminous boundaries with the police and the fire service, so that sometimes means that it's somebody from out with Argyll and Bute that's in the chair, and you know they're good and strong leaders, but I think there is something about living and working in a community and understanding that in terms of driving it forward. But I think, as an aside, and you've probably got this impression from my other answers, that it is about shifting that locus from the statutory bodies to the communities. So should it really be a fire commander or a police commander that's in the chair of really important work in terms of improving community wellbeing? So I don't know. Again, there needs to be governance round about that. But, you know, some of our community members, our community leaders, and lots of the really organic work that happens alongside community planning, and we haven't necessarily had a chance to talk about that yet, but there's a raft of work that happens because community members mobilise and they see something that they want to do and they do that and they achieve that and they make a difference. And that's not as a result of community planning. Sometimes community planning maybe takes a bit of the credit for that, but this is because people who fundamentally want to make their communities better. So I think maybe if that is my finishing point, it's about putting the community really at the heart of community planning and really empowering our community members.
Thank you, Alison. And online, Alison in Aberdeen.
Yeah, absolutely. I would agree with Craig in particular in terms of the leadership that we get from the local authority. There is absolutely a will from all of the community planning partners to be around and about it, but we rely very heavily on the local authority to make that happen, you know, to drive, make sure the meetings happen, make sure the project charters are completed, make sure the reports are in, etc. So I do feel that there probably is one partner that needs to be there and really take a grasp of that. And I would agree with Craig as well in terms of the, you know, allowing us the flexibility, you know, to have the membership of the community planning appropriate to the area and appropriate to needs as well, because there will be times when we need more input from certain organisations. Cost of living crisis is a very good example of that. I would echo Alison's comments around about it does tend to be quite top heavy, if you like, in terms of commanders and very people at a senior level. But I keep going back to that journey that we're on, and that perhaps, you know, it needed to start that way, and that eventually, hopefully, we'll be able to achieve that local-led vision that Alison has.
OK. Thank you very much, the three of you, for your contributions. Thank you. Convener?
Thanks, Willie. Yes, thank you for your contributions, and I think that's, I loved your metaphor. We often use it, the journey that we're on, the direction of travel, and hopefully the work that we're doing in the committee, taking all this evidence, will help us move in that direction of putting communities even more into the heart of the work that's being done. So thank you so much for joining us today. and to members, as we agreed at the start of the meeting, to take the next item in private, that, as that was the last public item on our agenda, I now close the public part of the meeting.